We are so happy that you're here in the building for Keep Service. I hope that you had a good little break and that you're back here in this service ready to see what the Lord has for us. We're going to let them play through another stanza or two and let you find a place to sit, and then we'll get started. We're so happy you're here. What a great song. And again, we're so happy that you're here in this service today. Today's Building for Keep service is going to be just a little different than perhaps what you're expecting or what you have grown accustomed to being a part of. And for the last many years, at least in my lifetime, I remember Building for Keep services as those services that I either was really happy that I was in because the speaker was so engaging and his stories or her stories of their past were so engaging that I was compelled to listen, or they were so boring that I was looking at where I was going to eat supper in just a few moments. And hopefully, we won't have anybody with their phones out looking at their dinner options here in just a few moments. But the Building for Keep services that I recall seem to center around rebuilding for keeps. A life that was broken, a life that was wrecked by sin, perhaps a life that started out well, but God's redeeming grace reached in and transformed them. And I praise God for that, don't you? I praise God that happened in my life. I was raised in a Christian home, and I went my own way. I tell people often, no amount of proper parenting can take care of the sin principle, but I'm so glad that I have a Heavenly Father who didn't give up on me and redeemed me, and my night became day. I've never gotten over that reality, and so I thank God for His grace and His power to redeem those years. But just as interested as I am in those stories, I'm interested in those who've never gone out, who've never lost their way. And their testimony is far greater than my testimony because they stayed with it and God's grace was sufficient for them. And so the purpose of this Building for Keep service this year is to talk about building for keeps. This started... the genesis behind this service started in a restaurant in Beaver Springs, Pennsylvania, with the Jameson Plank, Scott Loper, and Cameron going alongside of Brother Plank. And they were talking about their passion to see young people get integrated into the area conventions that we have all around the United States. And they were talking about ideas, and that quickly pivoted to the desire of all of us that our families be invested in the area conventions. We're interested in our families being a part. And then that quickly transitioned to, we've got to do whatever we can to keep our families. Amen? Amen. Whatever we've got to do, there's not a throwaway member of any family here today. And so whatever we've got to do to keep our families, that's what we're going to do. And the idea was born then, why don't we talk about this in the Building for Keep service and put an emphasis on raising our families well. And so that's what this service is about today. And to start it off, it's great to have the Cope family. They're going to come and sing for us at this time. And buckle your seatbelts. There's a lot of neat things going to happen in this service. We're so happy that you're here.
Well, he introduced us as the Cope family, and that's true, although in all reality, there's not many Copes left. Because one by one, my daughters have changed their last name, and now we have four son-in-laws. And I can say truly this afternoon that with the scripture, that I have no greater joy than to know that my children walk in truth. And I'm glad for my family today, but most of all, I'm glad we're a part of God's family.
Together for Well, praise the Lord. It's good to be a part of the family of God. Well, we have selected five different individuals from all over the United States to give just a few short keys that their family used to build for keeps. Now, we tried to choose people that had different kinds of backgrounds. Some of these people might have used these keys in their own families as they were raising their children. Some of them might not have children themselves, but these different keys that their family used has helped transform them and shape them into the people that they are today as they're going out into God's work. And then some of them didn't have quite the strongest upbringing, but they have on purpose done everything they can to on purpose make a difference and make up the difference so that they could raise their families for Christ. So we want to do a quick lightning round so that you can hear what worked for them. Brother Jones, if you would come and begin us in our lightning round.
The lightning round. My brother and I, Marsh, were raised by some truly wonderful parents. My father is a pastor. I'm a fourth-generation preacher, and we're both in the ministry, my brother and I, and we're very, very blessed. Dad always said that the effect is never as great as the cause, and he kind of knocked us down a little bit when he said that, but I want to tell you, I totally agree with him. He was a wonderful, wonderful father, and he really taught us what it meant to live out our Christian faith. He surrendered to the will of the Lord and was totally surrendered to it. At age 16, he stood up in his little church, said, I'm going to accept the call of the ministry. I know I may be poor as my parents have been poor in the ministry they were in, but I'm going to do it. And 6 months later, he had a massive heart attack. Put him in the hospital, thought he was going to die, but he recovered from that heart attack, and he stayed true to his commitment to enter into the work of the Lord, and he stood for Christ boldly over 50 years ministering the gospel. He stood before great congregations, he stood before little congregations, but he was consistent at home as he was in the pulpit. He was thoughtful, but he was thinking. He was a thinking Christian. He thought why he believed what he believed, and he shared that with us. So we didn't think that we should do what we were doing because it was just an idea that was out there. We had a reason for the hope that was within us. We had a clear biblical reason. He loved people, and he lived the Bible, and he loved the Word of God. Diligently. He stood with conviction. He took action. He was exciting as a Christian. He wanted us to do great things. He was weak physically, but strong in the spirit. Praise God. And he prayed for us. My mother was a wonderful, wonderful influence as well. In her last few years, she was smitten with dementia, and I would stay with her sometimes. And sometimes in the morning, she would get up, come out of her room, sit at the couch. She didn't notice I was even in the room. But the first book she grabbed every morning was the Word of God. And I have a wonderful picture of my mother reading the Word of God early in the morning, not even knowing I was even in the room. But I knew she loved the Word, and she loved the Lord of the Word. I'll give you one more story. My father, one time, sensed that his two boys were not walking very close with the Lord. Now, we had not gone into deep sin or anything. It was just he didn't like the direction, our tone. And we remember him getting us together and saying to us with tears in his voice, sons, the Bible says that a bishop should rule his own household and that he should make sure that he brings him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And if you can't serve the Lord, I'm going to leave the ministry until I know you are right with God. Tears streaming down his face. He didn't want to leave the ministry. He sure impacted two boys that began to realize we're not playing games. We're not goofing off. We're not here for just a party. We're here for a purpose. And God has called us to that purpose. And I thank God he instilled that in our hearts and gave us something worth living for. and someone worth dying for. Amen.
In Psalm chapter 16 and verse number 6, the Bible reads, "The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places." And then the psalmist takes a moment and just testifies to us, and he says, "I have a goodly heritage." In February of this year, I was standing beside my father at the close of Seabreeze Camp Meeting, and the service that night had dealt with the necessity of the intergenerational transfer of the faith, the necessity of passing the torch from generation to generation. And as the service ended, I turned to my father and said, "I want to thank you for the way that you and mother raised me." And on behalf of both my brothers and myself, I would like to echo that again publicly this afternoon. It was the greatest privilege of my life to be raised in a Christian home. What made the difference? They said, "Take 3 minutes and give three things that your parents did right." Very quickly, I would like to say, first of all, my parents cultivated a love for Christ. Our days began with Jesus. Between 6:30 and 6:45 on school days, the family would gather together, we would read the scripture, and then we would pray. I was a teenager before I knew that there were Christian homes where that did not happen, and there was not a regular family altar. Our parents cultivated a love for Jesus. They cultivated a love for the church. They made a purpose in the home not to go around and tear down and criticize the church and its people. And the reason for that was explained to me this way. It was said that if you have gone around your church and criticized every family, and you've criticized the preacher, when there comes a moment in your child's life when they feel the tug of the Holy Ghost and make their way to the altar, who knows? But that man or that woman that you've criticized and you've torn down would be the very one that God would use to bring your son or your daughter to the faith. And if you've torn them down and destroyed the confidence of your children in everything and everybody, you're systematically burning the bridges that could get them to God. My parents cultivated a love for Christ and a love for the church and a love for the Great Commission. If you're taking notes, my outline's already over. There it is. A love for the Great Commission. In the back of the auditorium of Pacific Bible College and on the campus of Pabrogook there in Papua New Guinea, there's a banner that reads, "Some pray, some give, and some go." My parents were prayers and givers. And they cultivated an appreciation and an awareness of the responsibility of the Great Commission. Missionaries were heroes in our house. Missionaries were actively involved in doing the work of the Lord. And in the atmosphere that they created there in the home, they created a culture within that family that made it easy to facilitate the conversion of their children. And for that, I am very grateful. Doesn't fit my three-minute, three-point outline, but I'll leave you with this. I remember as the Lord had opened the door for the purchase of a piece of property. The Lord had opened that door, and we had been to look at it, and we were coming back. And I remember there, as we were coming down the driveway, my father stopped the vehicle and shut it off right there in the road and looked at us as a family, and he said, "The Lord has blessed us. But if it all went away tomorrow," he said, "I still believe we would be just as happy. And because of the way they lived before me, I believe that with all of my heart. We've got to keep the main thing the main thing. I was not raised to leave. I was raised to stay. I'm not looking for a lesser way this afternoon. The lines have fallen unto me in pleasant places. I have a goodly heritage."
This afternoon, I speak on behalf of my siblings as well. We've had these conversations. We've talked with our parents about these things. This is nothing new for the conversations of our family. We thank you, Mom and Dad, for giving us a wonderful heritage all the way back to my grandparents. We feel nothing but sincere gratitude for what they've handed to us. It was not perfect by any means. But overall, like Ben said, they kept the main thing, the main thing. They put us kids first. When we were called to Hope Sound, I remember my dad saying, I'm not moving there until I have a promise from the Lord that my kids will be saved. The track record was not great at that point for that statistic to occur, but it did in our family, and thank the Lord. They protected us. We did not do sleepovers. That's very practical advice, but we did not do sleepovers. They went with us to youth camp. They did not send us to youth camp. Things like that. We all were launched into adulthood protected, unharmed. That's huge. If you've pastored, if you've heard stories, that's huge. Thank God. They were consistent. I woke up, I remember in my formative years, my dad's footsteps down the hall praying. I heard him crying and praying. That was my alarm clock in my formative years. It had a lasting impression, made a lasting impression on me. They were firm disciplinarians. They got some criticism for that. They were very firm. I remember my mom, when I was in college, 18 did not matter to my parents. It was just a number. I remember my mom pulling up. I was talking to a boy that they had laid firm outlines about. And I was talking long after church had ended in the parking lot, well lit, no problems there. But she pulled up. She said, Alyssa, you know you're not supposed to be here. You get in this car right now. I was over 18 years old. I was in college living at home. But guess what I did? I got in that car. And also, guess what I did? I married that boy. With their blessing, to this day, I married him, and they were complete. It's a whole nother wonderful story. But it pays to do it the Lord's way, though. I'll tell you that much. They loved. They loved, loved. It was not flowery. It was not fluffy. It was a firm, committed, consistent, loyal love. My dad knew I wanted to go to church camp. I was traveling for the school, and he knew I was 4 hours away on my day off for that week. He drove 4 hours one way to get me for one day. That's the kind of love I saw to this day. He took me to church camp, my kids and I, when he knew I couldn't do it on my own and my husband couldn't go. This last summer, he flew with me, stuck by me, and flew back. He's still showing that kind of love, as is my mother. Balanced view. We don't operate in extremes. I heard it over and over. We don't operate in extremes. There's no value in that. We look at this in a balanced way. They gave me a balanced view of God. Practical, simplistic. You have a need, present it in a simplistic way, and then expect results. They taught me, lastly, to weather difficult storms of life with grace, not around them, but through them. We're not trying to get away from them. They build character, my mom would say. They taught me, they have had some rough, rough storms in their lives. And they taught me to see them through with grace. And I have used that so as recently as in the last few months. I have gone back to that. And I've told them, thank you for being faithful in the storms, for me to see how to handle it. I cannot thank them enough. Let me challenge you, parents. I know there are some here that feel dejected by this part of the service because you probably feel like a failure. Don't. The story's not over. If you're young and you feel like you're blowing it, start right now. You've started. You're here. This is the place to start. Get them in church. If you're old and you've lost your kids, be right where you've always been because they're looking back. They need to see you doing what you've always done, consistently but lovingly leading them even in their adult years. And then pray. We have a wonderful heritage, and I plan with all my heart, my husband and I, to pass it on.
Hello, my name's Daniel Hardy Jr. That was my dad this morning. And let me just say, the first thing that came to my mind when we were asked about this, it actually came to my mind as I was sitting this morning listening, was that my dad has lived out what he preached. In the home, in public, everywhere. He's lived exactly what he preached. And that is why I'm here today. Being raised in a holiness preacher and missionary's home, as Brother Crawford mentioned, there was every opportunity for my parents to become bitter or for my parents to tear down people in front of us children, but we never once heard it. And it wasn't until I was a young adult that I found out some of the negatives of the holiness people. My dad always said, I don't want to say something negative about a person who God might want to use to be the salvation of my children. Even now, if there's something negative being done to my parents or in my parents' lives, I don't find out from them. I usually find out from others and have to go ask him about it then. The reason I am in Christian ministry today is because my parents chose to love the ministry. They chose to love the ministry and taught us to love it as well. We ministered together as a family. Another quick thing that taught us that was impactful to us was the love of sacrificing. Every Wednesday growing up was fast and prayer night at our house for supper. We either had a baked potato with butter or plain rice with butter. That's all we had for supper. And we would each be given a dollar to put into a little piggy bank. And then as a family, we would decide what mission project we would do as a family with that money. And it was exciting as a 12 and 13-year-old to send Bibles to Africa and support people that had never heard the gospel because of a baked potato and rice. It became exciting to sacrifice. I have said to my friends, my parents are my heroes. And I feel like Elisha, except I just say, Lord, just give me half. Just give me half. Dad, I want to be a chip off the block.
Good afternoon. We were given 5 minutes at this moment, and it's a delight to be at IHC. I'm Dan Durkee. I'm the least of those who have spoken. I don't have a story like any of them. Most of you know I came from a dysfunctional family, but I began my 40th year serving Jesus on Sunday morning, and I thank God for the change he made in my life as a 14-year-old kid in the inner city of St. Petersburg, Florida. He transformed my life, and I give God the praise. I remember one of the very first camp meetings. The evangelist singing family were the Wilford Edward family. I never saw anybody with such long arms leading the singing in my entire life. And I remember they sang a song that says, the family that prays together, stays together, lives together, loves together, smiles, and you know, all the way home. And I thought, oh God, if you would help me, I want to break the cycle in my family. I want to be a cycle breaker, and I want to be like that family. I have a family that loves you with all their heart and soul, mind and strength. And that was my prayer. That was my goal. And so Jonathan, Daniel, your family was such an inspiration to me back in camp meeting days. And that's why it's really important who's on our platforms and who's representing. And I'm indebted to your family. But I remember that song, and it inspired me. Went to Bible college, and God gave me a wonderful helpmate. And I remember traveling around the country and asking many of you, because I had no background, no godly father, no anybody in my life in that regard. And I asked many of you, what are things that you would tell me to raise a godly family? And I hear from you. And as I've thought about it over now these 30 years that I've had children, and now I've got 4 grandchildren, I don't even look like a grandpa. And God's been so good to me. But I thought about it. And I thought about the thought, a family that prays together. And I made a decision a long time ago that my boys would serve Jesus. They would live for God. And frankly, the Durkee boys became Christians before they were Christians. You understand that language? They became Christians. I mean, it was very normal. We went to prayer meeting on Wednesday night. We went to church on Sunday. We went to camp. There was never a question in our home, Dad, are we going to prayer meeting? Dad, are we going to camp meeting? Dad, are we going to youth camp? Dad, are we going to revival meeting? It was just a part of our life. You know why? Because we were Durkies, and therefore we are Christians, and therefore we're serving Jesus even before they became a Christian. And that was our family's desire. And God so helped us. And so I thought about that, the family that prays together. And then I thought about the family that plays together. You got to spend time with your children. Oh, the board games of Monopoly and chess and checkers and softball and basketball and volleyball and hunting and fishing and all those things. We do them together. You know why? Because we're a family. And we're going to heaven together by God's grace and God's help. And I'm convinced that's a very, very important part, that they see that you don't just serve Jesus on Sunday morning and Sunday night in the house of God. But they see it everywhere you go and everything you do and all that you do. All of your activities, you're living for Jesus and you're letting your light shine. So I believe the family that prays together, and I believe the family that plays together, and frankly, I believe the family that stays together. You know, I remember going to all these places, and we took our kids to youth camp. We didn't send them. They stayed with us. We took them to camp meeting. We didn't send them. We go to revival at your church, and you'd ask them, you know, if our boys could stay overnight with your kids, and we'd say, no, they're staying with us. I've got one shot at this. And not that I don't trust you, but I don't trust the devil. There's my timekeeper. It's been 4 minutes. Thank you so much. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know, I'm convinced with all my heart that the family that prays together and plays together can stay together, and by God's grace and God's help, we can go to heaven together. Amen? Oh, I thank God for what he's done. I'm the least of least, but I give God the glory and God the praise.
Praise God. God is so faithful, isn't he? He wants to keep your family, and he wants to do everything he can for you. The Howland family is coming to sing. Let's pray for them as they sing.
I will follow Christ, carry the choose to be a Christian. I will follow Christ, carry the cross that leads to life. I will be true, stand for my convictions, whatever others do. I choose to be a Christian. I will be true. I am not ashamed.
I'll stand for my convictions.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's my testimony this afternoon. Praise God. And I'm just blessed. These speakers have done such a wonderful job so far. And there's more to come. This next segment that we will be having in this service is focused on providing helpful tips to parents. And we will be discussing four topics: parenting toddlers. And Sister Dorcas Hallam and Brother Matt Hallam are going to be discussing. They can head this way at this time. And then the next subject will be parenting school-age children, ages 5 to 12, and that will be Sister Valerie Quesenberry. She will be coming to talk to us about that subject. Then parenting through the teens, Sister Laura Ferguson is going to come and talk to us about that subject. Then from teens to adults, Brother Jonathan Edwards is going to be coming and talking to us about from teens to adults. And I am so excited to hear what they're going to have to share with us this afternoon. Tune your hearts to what they have for us this afternoon.
You might be the parent of a toddler if, at the end of the meal, there's more food under your kitchen table than on it. You might be the parent of a toddler if you've ever tried to re-roll an entire roll of toilet paper. You may be the parent of a toddler if you spell talk to others even when there are no KIDSs around. You might be the parent of a toddler if your monthly budget has its own separate line for baby wipes. And last, you might be the parent of a toddler, and I think this one really tells us apart, parents of toddlers. Your idea of a good time includes going to Walmart alone on a Saturday night. So what is successful parenting when it comes to raising toddlers? Many, for very good reason, will say success during the survival years is summed up in one word, and that is survival for both the parents and the kids.
But as Christians, successful parenting needs to be more than merely surviving our children and our children surviving us. In Deuteronomy 6, God says, "And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them while thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up."
The toddler years matter. We can't just ignore toddlers, give them an iPad, and check back in with them in their teenage years. What happens at the ages of 1, 2, 3, and 4 sets the tone for the rest of their lives. So while survival is important, we have three more S's for you to write down in crayon or broken pencil or whatever it is that you have that may help guide you through these toddler years.
The first S is structure. If you have toddlers, you know IHC does not bring out the best in them. And by the time it's over, it may not bring out the best in you. You can't always control the circumstances, but you can keep expectations consistent. Whenever our kids acted out in public, we did the best we could. We tried to survive that moment. And then we had a ritual that we did in private. It was kind of like Simon Says, only it was Daddy and Mommy Says. We'd say, "Caleb, run, touch the doorknob." And he'd have to run, touch the doorknob. We'd say, "Caleb, go pick up the pillow and put it back on the couch." And he'd have to go pick up the pillow and put it back on the couch. And we found our first child, it was a little harder than the other ones because he was a little, it took a little longer. Sometimes he just wanted to sit down and get distracted. Sometimes we did this when he was there very, very little. But it was amazing how those short training periods in private saved us a lot of embarrassing moments in public.
The second S is safety. I always like to get people to interact, and you've been sitting for a while, so this is probably dangerous, but you look like adults that I can trust, so I want everyone to stand up. And then I want you to turn around and find someone not in your row, but someone either behind or in front of you, and just look at them. Just turn around and look at them, so you can just turn and look at them. I have a question. They look like a pretty nice person, right? Can I hear an amen? You trust them, of course. Now we're going to put that trust to the test. I want you to take out your wallet or your purse. I want you to hand it to them. Now I want you to turn around and sit down. Will the ushers please come forward? Just joking. Please get back your wallets and your purse and your other valuables. I don't want to be responsible for it, and I take no ownership if something happens and the person wasn't trustworthy. But I have a question that I think we all need to answer, and that is, why do we trust people with our kids who we wouldn't trust with our wallet or our phones? There's a lot of good people out here. There's a lot of good people out there in your churches. But there are some bad ones. And the problem is that they don't always look like bad people. Protect your kids. Don't be naive. Just because someone's a cousin, or just because someone's an uncle, or because someone's a family friend or a leader in your church, doesn't mean that you should automatically trust them alone with your children. This can put you in awkward circumstances, and believe me, people that have bad intentions for your children will try to put you into awkward circumstances where they have to test your trust. Be awkward. Protect your children. Your toddlers are more valuable than any wallet. They're more valuable than any purse. You need a very short list of people, and this list should include older children. People and older children you trust alone with your children.
The third S is spiritual formation. 2 to 4 isn't too young for their heart to love God. If my kids reach the age of 6 or 7 years old and are still actively lying and willfully being disobedient, the red warning lights should be going off in my mind. Two things that we taught our toddlers are very, very little. We repeated it over and over. I painted it and put it on the wall. The greatest thing in all the world is to love and serve Jesus and to help others love him too. We help them live this out. One simple way was by giving them a little picture Bible they read every night. Long before they could read, I bought them each clip-on lights for their bed, gave them their Bible book, and left the room. Prayer time was simple, but I checked in with them often. You're 3 years old? You can pray for 3 people tonight that are not Christians. Maybe they can become Christians because you're praying for them. You're four years old? Let's read four. You can read four books, pages in your little Bible book. Or though on our older kids, we did this one a lot. You can read as many books tonight as the people that you pray for. I'd come back in the morning and the floor was covered with books because they had prayed for so many people. The second thing that's been really important to us in spiritual formation is ministry involvement. Our kids have heard it, I don't know, 1,000 times. We are blessed to be a blessing. We wanted our kids to be actively involved in ministry, and they are. This started very young. We have always pastored largely to unchurched people, so they were there right by our side. During family devotions, we began pretty early on, letting them each take a night to lead. It is always very simple, but they are in charge. We wanted them to feel comfortable leading. When we went shopping, I remember very little in the cart. I remember repeating every single compliment that the clerks or anyone would say about them behaving well. Lots of other kids act up when they go to the store, but did you hear that clerk? She said, "You were so polite. You said thank you. You maybe could influence her to become a Christian someday because of your behavior." I wanted even their smiles or their good behavior in the store or anywhere we went to make them feel that they were a witness to others. We are raising our children to build God's kingdom, not to build our own reputation. Today in our home, the verse I have on the wall surrounding all of their pictures is this: "Here am I, Lord, send me." Yeah. I hope this reminds them of their part in the Great Commission, but I think maybe more often it reminds me, because our 5 children are not ours. They belong to the Lord.
So to all you parents of toddlers, on behalf of IHC, we thank you for your service. We pray that you will survive these years and at the same time set a foundation for your toddlers to become older children who love and serve Jesus.
When I was a newly married woman, I'm from the generation that married young. I was barely 19 when I married my husband. I thought that women who had school-aged children were really getting older. I mean, a woman with a baby still seemed kind of young to me, you know, a cute little baby. But a woman who had children who were already in school seemed like a very hard season of life. And I wasn't wrong. It is hard. It is challenging. But I can tell you from experience that they are some of the most rewarding years as well, as you look back on them. It is in these crucial years that you lay the groundwork for the character, attitude, personal stability, and the spiritual appetite your child will have in the future. When I was in child development class under Mrs. Sheila Wolf at God's Bible School and College, I remember one class period where she focused on the theme of, you have them until they're five. Now, she didn't mean that parents don't matter after that, but rather that many of the important things are introduced before your child is at the age of five. She used the biblical stories of Moses and Samuel for reference points. And what Dorcas and Matt Hallam just shared are some valuable things that we can put into practice to teach them these things foundationally before they're the age of five. So grateful for that encouragement. But now that we've taught them everything up to that point, what happens now? We enter the school years, and that really changes the family dynamic. Some of us will homeschool, some of us will use traditional public school, and some of us will enroll our children in private Christian schools. And this is a decision that must be made prayerfully and carefully with both parents on board and contributing to the discussion. Whatever we decide, you recognize, please recognize that the lion's share of your child's optimal daytime hours will be spent in school. So where that happens matters. And if we enroll our children in private or public school, or even if we decide to use a state-offered home curriculum, we are giving someone else the opportunity to speak to our children. So let's be sure that we are in agreement as spouses and that we've talked to the Lord about what is going to be taught under that umbrella of education. I feel very strongly that the appetites we encourage in the school age years will shape them for the entirety of their lives. What we encourage and cement now will be the things with which they conquer life through Christ or because of which they fail in life. Obviously, there is personal choice and temperament here. A parent is not responsible for the decisions of a grown child. But I wonder if we truly recognize how powerful these years are in terms of lifelong effect. Children do not come into the world a total blank slate, but they do come into arms as a kind of soft plastic. They have a God-given gender, a temperament, physical and emotional characteristics, but their philosophies and attitudes and opinions are largely static, pure, translucent. They do not have these yet, and they will form them from living in our home under our instruction and influence. They have a sin nature, but they've not yet molded the expression of this. And so we can shape and influence that even before they come to Christ. So in the few moments we have left, how can we tip the scales to put an appetite in their mouths, as Proverbs 22:6 says, to mark them indelibly for God? What actionable things can we put into practice? I think we have to love them, obviously love them. Love the person they are. Love the process. Love not just the person they're becoming, but love the becoming stage. You know, when they have their teeth are coming in and they're just learning to do their hair and they learn how to tell their first joke. You remember that? Love that. You know, hang on to that. These are the children that you are making, molding into adults with God's help. Give them a taste for what you want them to be. You want them to go to Bible college? Take them to visit now. Waiting till they're 18 is too late. You want them to play an instrument? Start now and do it positively. You want them to be well-groomed as an adult? Don't just teach them the basics, but teach them how to look well, how to be acceptable looking for whatever environment they're in. Want them to pray about everything? Do it yourself and remind them to do it. Small children are so malleable. I remember when my oldest was young, she went through a phase where she took a lot of notebooks to church, which I was thrilled that she was doing that. She was taking notes, and she got quite a collection. And I was just curious what was going through her mind. And I said, Ashley, why are you taking these notes? What are you going to do with them? And she said, well, I'm keeping them in case I backslide someday. I thought that... Thankfully, that has not happened, but she was thinking ahead of her spiritual future. Nick's bad habits. Tone of voice matters. You don't want them to have a lazy or entitled attitude. Delayed obedience is disobedience. Disrespect for authority should be handled immediately and well. Don't allow sullenness or silence. Don't allow outbursts. You know age appropriateness here. But I used to tell my children, until you have self-control, you will have mom control. And so the goal is to get them to control themselves. Spanking does work. Nothing that God says is good could be bad for your children. Cast a vision for them. Know in your mind what you want them to be, and everything should contribute to that. Pray for them. I used to tell my mom, I don't really know how to pray for my children and when they were young. She said, oh, honey, you will. And pray for them in every season. Enjoy them. Love every minute that you can. Live them to the full. Love, pray. God will help you to parent. And you are changing the world with God's help as you parent your school-aged children.
Good afternoon. I am to discuss parenting teenagers. Parenting is an incredible privilege, but it also requires tremendous amounts of energy, thought, prayer, and counsel. My husband, Kurt, and I read and studied every Christian parenting resource we could get our hands on. We knew we needed wisdom. We knew the task was too big for us, so we sought God and listened to anyone he wanted to use to help us. I believe one's parenting experience with teenagers will vary depending upon what has happened up to that point, but I will share with you some perspective that specifically helped us and our girls. We have to give our teens vision, but vision for what? First, a vision for what is real and what is eternal. To begin, we parents have to be totally convinced that Jesus is who he said he was, and that in order to flourish, that is, to have that life abundant, we must live as he lived. In other words, we parents have to trust him, and then we have to build trust with our children. They need to see that we are what we say we are, and that we live out what we say we believe. They need to see Jesus working his likeness in us. If we want our teenagers to be pursuers of truth, to be humble and teachable, to treat others as precious, then we have to be that kind of person before them. If we come to recognize a failure in our own lives, we must confess and repent and ask God and our teens to forgive us, and then seek to restore their trust, doing whatever it takes to walk in the light, thereby showing our precious children how the redemption and transformation that Jesus offers really works. When parenting teens, it is essential to face reality with an eternal perspective rooted in honesty, openness, and trust. Second, we have to instill in our teens a vision of what is truly good. God is the only source of true good. We humans think we know what is good, especially for ourselves. In reality, though, by nature, we are slaves to our appetites, our feelings, and images. We must give our teenagers the vision that God made us, he knows how we work best, and he wants us to flourish. He hasn't placed arbitrary restrictions on us. He loves us. Our teenagers need to know that most naturally, when something appeals to them, they will desire it, whether it's good or not. They feel drawn to things and are prone to ask, is there anything wrong with it? We instructed our girls and believed with all our hearts that the questions you ask can drastically affect where you end up. We told them, anytime you feel a desire to do something, you should ask, why should I? Not, is there anything wrong with it? You should ask, is this something that God says will help me experience the abundant life? Do the people who do this truly flourish? We don't know what is good, and we don't know what is going to turn out good in the long run. However, our Creator knows, and if we are going to experience abundant life as well as eternal life together with God, we have to trust him in every area of life to guide us into what is truly good. Third, our teens need a vision for relationship with us and with others. Get this. It's really, really important. Our most effective and important parenting, in teen years especially, is done in the non-conflict moments. So not when we're disciplining or correcting, but just as we're living life with them, working, eating, playing, in times of fellowship and worship, when making choices, prayerfully thinking and talking about why we do what we do, responding to difficulties, making sense of things with our children as we seek to understand and establish the reasons behind our decisions. When we lacked sufficient understanding to make an informed decision, we sought counsel from other godly friends and family. Our girls have told us that it was helpful that we encouraged them to develop friendships with other godly adults as teens. Fourth, teenagers need a vision of themselves. We must help our teenagers understand themselves and the influences upon them. Being crucified with Christ and committing our entire being to the will of God is more of a beginning than an end. We must, as best we can, understand ourselves, ever pursuing a deeper understanding. We must seek to understand our thoughts, our feelings, our motivations, so that we become informed enough to help our children sort through theirs. The essence of the human problem lies within the will, and understanding what we do with our will is crucial. Jesus so beautifully exemplified what God intended. His entire life was characterized by, "Father, not my will, but thine be done." He trusted that God knew what was ultimately good for him. He lived carefully and proactively, refusing to allow his natural desires to control his will. Our teenagers must understand that their will most naturally will be captured and controlled by things rather than submitted to God. As we work through this in our own lives, we are responsible to help our children in this area. Teenagers are endlessly pounded by images and ideas that can enslave them as easily as alcohol, nicotine, cocaine, and heroin. If we hope for our children to not be overcome by the enemy of their souls, but to become captivated by the vision of belonging to the kingdom of God, we have to help them understand what's going on inside their own hearts and help them wisely guard against outside influences. Finally, teenagers must be given a vision of belonging productively to the kingdom of God. So we guard against the influences that would take them away from God, but it is equally important to fill up our teens' lives with good things that occupy their time and use their energy to develop skills and abilities that give them something to contribute to the kingdom for the good of others. We must focus during these years not on constant no's, but on intentional yeses. We must nurture possibilities and give our young people a sense of belonging, love, joy, and growth in community. We need to make room for them to contribute with their skills and their service. We need to invest in them to help them develop their interests and abilities, opening their eyes to ways they can be useful to the kingdom of God. This gives them a vision of purpose and joy and blesses everyone around them. No matter where your teens are at this moment, if they're still alive, the story is not over. And no matter where you are or where you have been with your teenagers, the best thing you can do right now is to become as much like Jesus as you possibly can. My husband read what Kent Stettler wrote on Facebook about his dad, Steve, after his dad passed away. He said, and I quote, "He made serving Jesus look attractive." Kurt has quoted that many times, and he and I both want that to be the picture of our lives. Does your life, your spirit, your attitude attract or repel your teenagers? Do they see joy, contentment, and happiness bubbling out of you as you follow Jesus? Or do they see drudgery, duty, and obligation? If they don't see him as he truly is in all his beauty, they are naturally going to look elsewhere. Godspeed, parents. Don't forget, we are not alone.
It is my responsibility to deal with the topic, taking teens into adulthood, and I want to say that I consider it a great honor to follow these who have already spoken today, because it is my intention to build upon what they have already stated. If you wait till the children are teenagers or nearing adulthood to begin to address what I'm going to address today, it's just too late or it's much more difficult. In no way do I want to create despair in the heart of a parent who may not have come to the Lord when your children are young and may have come to the Lord in a later date. I want you to know God still has grace to give you wisdom and guidance. But the scriptures tell us very specifically in Psalm 127 and verse 3, children are an heritage of the Lord. I would consider it the pinnacle of folly to squander any inheritance in any form, and of greatest value, the inheritance that God gives to you as parents, that being your children. I want to remind you that your children are all that you have that you can take to heaven with you. You cannot take your nice, shiny cars. You cannot take your beautiful homes. You cannot take your properties and your assets, but you can take your children, and since they are an heritage from the Lord, you need to invest everything in them that you can to prepare them to be ready for heaven. I believe that in taking the challenge of doing what we can with this inheritance that God has given us and to in no way squander it, as parents, when our children are in those very crucial teen years leading them into adulthood, we need to continue to pray for them. I read from the book of Job. You might say, well, you know, that's just something when they're little children. It must start there for sure. But let me remind you what we read in Job chapter 1 and verse 5. We read that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. The context is about his adult children. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. And this is the part that is so convicting to me. Thus Job did continually. How important it is for us, while it is important to start when they're young. You may think I'm weird. I started praying with my children when they were in the womb. I am confident that they knew my voice as soon as they were born. I spoke to them and they got quiet and listened. They'd heard that voice already before. But that praying must continue into the realms of adulthood. We are familiar with the term, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. It is important that we do everything we can to prevent them from going into realms of corruption, then try to deal with that and spend hours praying to try to bring them out of corruption. Again, I'm not trying to create despair for those that may be dealing with situations that are beyond your control, but as long as they are under my household, I want to do everything I can. Their specific needs may change from the time they're children to the time they are adults, but their need for prayer does not. They continue to need our prayers. I move quickly to the second point that I want to emphasize. It is a part of making sure we do not squander our inheritance, and that is we need to do our part to prepare them for adulthood. An experiment was done in which they took perfectly genetically produced plants and put them in a greenhouse. They applied the maximum possible amount of fertilizer and everything in the realms of nourishment that those plants would need. And they were endeavoring to come up with a great result of their experiment that would show that they had been able to produce the greatest of production from that plant in that setting. And it was an abject failure. And do you know what they found out? There was one important item missing for those plants to be productive. It was the wind. A part of preparing our children for adulthood is to help them in making choices. The scripture says train up. It doesn't say teach a child in the way he should go. It says train. Train involves working with them and allowing them to make choices and decisions. Train implies much more than a lecture. I would interpret training as on-the-job training. I recognize that it may be a temptation in our culture today to be overprotective with
teens that are nearing adulthood and feel like we have to continue to almost be obsessed with over-sheltering them. But I believe we are removing the wind when we do that, that is necessary to help them to be the adults they need to be. I believe that it is important to train them to pray, not just at home, but in public. I agree with everything that has been stated up to this point by the others. It's so vital and so important. But when my children were teenagers, I like to call on them to pray in a public setting. I want them to learn to pray publicly, to be comfortable to pray in that setting. I trained them in the realms of outreach. When my children were still at home, they were my greatest asset in touching people in the community. I still have people and families in our church that are the result of my children being involved and included in our ministry in outreach. That's training. If you just sort of let them sit on the seat and expect them to grow up to do what they need to do, they're not going to have that experience, but they need to have that experience at making choices and involved in outreach. I believe it even involves training them in the areas of work. When my children were in their early teens, actually, they were very involved. We were blessed to be in a setting where they could work with me. And interestingly enough, on one occasion, while we live in a very rural community and the community where we live, we were all pretty much on the same page. But we had a family that was transplanted from a city area into our area. And they threatened to call the CPS on me because I was abusing my 12-year-old son. I was forcing him to work in the field. He was on a 250-horsepower tractor pulling a 30-foot field cultivator, and they were going to turn me into CPS. And I said, feel free. If they interview my son, he's on my side. Take a look at the smile as he roars past your house on his face. Yes, well, CPS didn't end up being called. But do you know what? That 12-year-old boy is now 30 years of age, and he is my youth pastor in the church. And by the way, along with my brother, he is my right-hand man on the farm, driving bigger equipment now than he did then. It's important to train them. But not only in the areas of work, I trained them, I allowed them to make decisions on their own. I was there, I was encouraging them to make the right decisions, but I let them make those decisions. I've always stated it was my philosophy to make it as easy as possible for them to make the right decisions and as hard as possible for them to make the wrong decisions. Ultimately, it's still their choice. Ultimately, they're the one that makes that choice, but I want to do what I can to guide them. But if you don't allow them to make some of those decisions while they are somewhat under your care, you won't be able to lead them in the right direction. But when one of my sons was 17, he had the natural and appropriate interest in a young lady, but I wasn't necessarily supportive of the choice. But rather than just telling him that I was not going to allow him to have anything to do with her, I said, I want you to pray about it. And I want you to give consideration to that. And as the course of time went by, there was a bit of a relationship. In fact, on one occasion, they chose to go to an event that I wasn't necessarily supportive of, but I continued to pray and we talked about it. We always had very open communication. And within a short period of time, that son of mine recognized it was a wrong choice and he made the right decision. And today he is very happily married to a wonderful, godly young lady. But it was important to train them in that. It is so important for us to recognize that a part of preparing them for adulthood is to allow them to be involved in that decision making. I want to bring this to a close as we look at a third important point that really should continue from the beginning all the way as long as we live, and that is that we need to be present in their lives. No, my children don't need me to take their hand to walk them across the street anymore. No, my children don't need me to pick out their clothes for them. Actually, I'm getting to an age where they'd like to help pick my clothes out for me. You mean you're going to wear those tennis shoes, Dad?
those are a little outdated. Let me get you some new shoes. Hey, feel free. But the reality is they still need us present. Our Heavenly Father in Matthew chapter 28 and verse 20 tells us, "Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." No, I'm not talking about being overbearing. No, I'm not talking about breathing down their neck. But do you know when they are adults, they still need your presence. They still need to know that you care. That's a part of our responsibility. I have spent hours on a concrete floor working with my boys on cars. My wife, with her creativity, has spent hours with our children while they were in college working on projects. And guess what? Now that they're married, I have still been involved in doing plumbing repairs and electrical repairs and other things because I want to be there for them. Do you know what? I communicate with them regularly, even now. All of them are married. The reality is they still need my presence. And do you know that we recognize, I think all of us would recognize, for any relationship to be strengthened, it involves communication. It involves spending time together. When my children were young, I told them, "I am the happiest when we're all gathered together around my table." I told them not very long ago, and they're all married, I still feel the same way. I'm happiest when we're all together. If I go 3 weeks without talking to one of my children, I'm on the phone, I'm communicating, I'm texting them, I'm finding out what's happening. I call to check on how things are going on the job for those that are not living close to me. I check on them regularly. It is important for you, even in their adult, to be alert to their needs. Pray with them. Ask them regularly, "What can I help you pray with right now? What area can I help you pray in?" It is so important for us to be there and be present, even in their adulthood. And you know what? Now, I've got the great opportunity to start working on the next generation. And if you want to see any pictures of my grandchildren, I've got them close at hand.
You know Scott Loper or myself, you know that we make our fathers extremely nervous. And thank you for your patience in this service. We have very loud opinions, and this time they said, "Well, why don't you do it?" And so blame us. But I believe this has been a wonderful thing, and I'm so thankful for the godly home God allowed me to be in. And I want to just publicly say thank you to my dad. And he calls me, he supports me as a young pastor, and it means so much, and I hope that you do that for your kids as well. Just moments ago, Scott Loper and I were putting together the schedule for this service, and we did not put an offering. And we thought, well, how is that going to work? And I told Scott, it'll be all right. And as we were back here in the stage before the service, my dad said, "There is no offering on the flyer, on the handout." And I said, "Oh, it'll be all right." He said, "IHC began in 1952, and there has never been a service without an offering." I said, "Praise the Lord. It's going to be a great service." And during this session, I got a text that the need of IHC has already been supplied. And so we thank the Lord. And we're trusting the Lord to help us in the future. And this is just a brief overview of what we hope to do in the future. Brother Loper is going to come and share just a little bit of what's going to be happening in our local conventions and a short testimony, and then the children are going to sing, "Continue to Mind the Lord in this service."
Yes, Brother Jameson and Brother Scott make Brother Plank and I terribly nervous, and they don't know what they're going to say. We surely don't know what they're going to say, and so it is with great trepidation that we allow them on the platform, but anyway, it's hopefully this has been encouraging to you, and you've taken some tips maybe. Some of you may be thinking, wow, I'm out of that stage of life. How does that apply to me? You have grandchildren. You also have children in your church that need that influence and need that help, and I hope that you will do that. One of the other things that we're passionate about is passing on our beliefs to the next generation. It's wonderful to be a great parent, right? But it's another thing to take what we believe and pass it to the next generation. If I were to ask you as an individual right here tonight or this afternoon, why do you believe what you believe? Could you give me an answer? I don't care what your church believes. I really do, but for this argument, I don't. I really don't care what grandma and grandpa believed. I don't care what your church discipline says. I don't care what your favorite Bible college has in their rule book. What motivates you to believe what you believe? And can you pass that on to your children in a biblical, logical progression? Well, I believe that we can. I don't think we have to run from that question. I don't think we have to be afraid of that question. I think that we can embrace that and engage in that conversation in a way that we can transfer what we hold important to the next generation. Katie Arnold is here. She was in an event where that happened, and she's going to share a testimony of what happened when she sat through some of those sessions.
Good afternoon. It is a huge honor for me to be able to be here with you today and to be able to share a very small piece of what the Lord has been doing in my life this past year. To give you a little background, I'll first tell you that I was raised in a Christian home. Many of you may have known or heard of my dad, David Webster. He was a pastor and had an amazing story of how God saved him from a life of drugs, crime, and as my dad would describe it, the pit of sin. Growing up in a pastor's home, I was taught how to love God and have a relationship with him, and I remember accepting Jesus into my heart when I was 7 years old. When I turned 18, I went to Bible college for a year and a half, and then after that, I moved out on my own, and my life started to spiral out of control. After a couple of years of sinful living, I finally got back to church, but still had not found that deep relationship with God. I managed my Christian life by asking the questions, well, what's wrong with that? Does it really matter what I do or how I present myself? Does God really care about the little things? In March of 2013, I moved to Lebanon, Pennsylvania, and started attending the God's Missionary Church. It was there that I met my husband, and we were married the next year. We have continued attending the same church and are raising our three beautiful children there. I feel like for as long as I can remember, I've just gone through the motions of being a Christian. I knew what to say and do to make it look good, but I never really had that deep moment of connection with Jesus. Last year, in February of 2023, our church sponsored a Young Adults Weekend, and they asked Rodney and Melissa Loper to come share with us over the course of 2 days. The focus topic was why we believe what we believe. Brother Loper did multiple sessions and we covered a myriad of topics. His main focus was what he called the four pillars of the conservative holiness movement. One, we believe in salvation, which means we are saved by grace through faith, having our sins washed away. We believe in entire sanctification by grace through faith, which is the believer's complete surrender to God, and God making the believer holy in heart and conduct. We believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, which means God's word is without error or fault in all of its teachings, inspired by God and infallible. We believe in holy, careful living, which is biblical modesty, clear gender distinction, a simple lifestyle, and separation from the world. I learned that these four pillars work together to build a strong foundation for our walk with the Lord. When you get rid of one, it has a domino effect on the other pillars. Throughout the sessions, I felt the Lord clearly speaking to me, especially about holy, careful living and sanctification. However, I still was not fully understanding the meaning or need for sanctification. Then when Brother Loper explained sanctification, we all sensed the energy and relief fill the room. I, along with many others, had always felt that sanctification was non-essential and unattainable. The way I'd heard it preached about and described, it almost has seemed as if you had to beg God for it or you couldn't receive it. It also felt like I needed an experience like others had described, or that I needed a huge dramatic event in my life for it to actually happen. Brother Loper made it so clear that sanctification is simply the next natural step in your walk with God. Every person's experience with sanctification will be different, just as everyone's relationship with God is unique. He told us, just simply come to God and surrender and say, Lord, here I am. You've saved me from my sins, and now I want to give you full access and control in my life. If there's anything you need to change, I'm willing to do it, whatever I need to do. And then believe that he will do it. After the sessions were over on Sunday afternoon, we went back to church that Sunday night, and as Brother Loper preached, I just sat and cried the entire service. I knew that I hadn't given God full access to my life. I went to the altar and prayed and told the Lord that whatever he needed from me, I was willing to do it. Whatever changes needed to be made, I was ready. I walked away from that altar and I knew that everything was clear and that the Lord had sanctified me. I knew what God was asking of me. The next morning, I cleaned house of everything the Lord was telling me to, and the whole time I could feel the devil whispering to me, that's not really necessary. You're going to be so miserable without all of these things. Is it really that big of a deal? I just ignored him and kept on. You see, if I told you the things that I was getting rid of, you might say, well, why would God care about that? But the thing is, God knew that these were all things that were distracting me from being closer to him. I found out that the little things do matter, and they were holding me back from full surrender to God. After that morning, I can't explain to you the incredible peace I felt. Don't get me wrong, though. The road hasn't been easy. The devil has fought me so hard every step of the way. But in the midst of the devil fighting, God has been there every moment of every day. Through this past year, I have learned the key to a successful Christian life is obedience. When I learned to listen to God's voice and say yes, this powerfully changed my marriage, my children, my relationships, and my everyday decisions. I've learned that having God's forgiveness and being completely surrendered to him has helped me establish healthy boundaries and forgive others as God has forgiven me. When I forgave others, even though they may not have asked for it, I released all of my hurt and anger to God, and he brought healing and wholeness. I'm forever grateful for our precious church family that has literally carried us through the last year with prayers and words of encouragement. I'm also so very grateful for Brother and Sister Rodney Loper for being willing to let God use them. My life and my family's life are forever changed because of their passion for sharing the beauty that can come from living a God-honoring, holy, and conscientious life. My prayer today is that you will be encouraged. I want you to know that God wants to make something beautiful out of your life. He can take all of that brokenness, confusion, and hurt and bring wholeness, clarity, and forgiveness. He can take all the mountains and valleys in your daily journey and lead you into a steady, consistent walk with him. In the midst of all of life's chaos, you can have peace. Simply say, here I am, Lord. Whatever you want for me, I'm ready. And then rest and obey. If God can do it for me, I promise he can do it for you.
Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. What a powerful thing to have all of this, these comments, these instructions, what my parents did right, Tips for Parents by Scott Loper and company, and what my parents did right, and then to have this beautiful testimony here. And while this is all happening, rows and rows and rows of our children coming out onto the platform. We're claiming every one of these children for Jesus Christ. Not one of these kids belonged to this world. They were dedicated to God, and we're claiming every one of them for our future, for God's kingdom, be called into his purpose as missionaries and preachers and godly lay people in our churches. Church janitors and church pianists and church organists and church Sunday school teachers and bus workers, they're all coming up on the platform behind me, and it ought to bless your heart, even if you're tired on an afternoon. Thank God for this service We called it Building for Keeps for many, many years. It's been called Building for Keeps, the desire to make sure that our homes are strengthened and our families are saved. And even if there's been hurt and loss, that Jesus can restore all wonderful, wonderful things that have gone into these Building for Keeps services across many years. But today we are announcing that this is going to become a new ministry of IHC that we are calling Building for Keeps. It's no longer going to be just one service at the annual convention. We're going to have Building for Keeps conventions across America where we can help our families and strengthen our homes and encourage our moms and our dads and help our children and our young people. So what we're doing is we're going to select several conventions a year. We've asked Brother Loper to be one of the main speakers to present these four pillars, okay? Four pillars of the holiness people. And I even wrote them down and can't find them, but she just, why can I not find them right this minute? Salvation by grace through faith alone. Entire sanctification, I found it now, by faith through grace alone. And inerrancy of Scripture. And holy, careful living, just like Sister Katie mentioned and how it helped her so much. And so the very first one will be this fall. Put it down on your calendar. It will be in Shelbyville, Indiana. We have a wonderful convention there every year, and all of our conventions are wonderful. And if you'd like your convention to be a Building for Keeps convention, we can arrange that into the future because we're going to have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, however many Brother Loper will give us, a year Building for Keeps conventions. It will be in Shelbyville, Indiana. It's always been a great convention, and this year will be very special. It will be October 1 through 5, October 1 through 5, Shelbyville, Indiana, our very first Building for Keeps convention. Well, I think this is pretty exciting. I think it's needed. And how many think it's needed? How many are in favor? Ah, praise God. All in favor, aye. All opposed, no, the ayes have it. Praise God. That's how Rodney Loper runs the business meetings. I've learned it from him. Well, this is a wonderful children's choir. We called children's workers all the way from British Columbia, Canada, to be part of this convention this year. And Kent and Laura Engel and their family have done an excellent job. And they're going to present the children's part of this to us at this time. And when this has concluded, we want all of the parents to come up and claim your kids. Any leftover children, we will auction off in the service tonight.
Ah! If you can say amen to that, let me hear ya. Amen. I'm glad that God has the answer to all my sin. And I am committed to follow him. And these kids have been singing their hearts out all week long up there and worshiping God. And we've been sensing his presence. And I tell you, while you've been having church down here, God has been meeting with us and we've been having church up there. And I'm thankful for that. And I want to just take a moment to say thank you to all the moms and dads for letting your children come and be a part of Chapel of the Children 2024. They're a great group of kids, and I and my wife, Laura, have thoroughly enjoyed working with them this week. And we've been studying this week. Our theme has been RX. We took the R out of prayer and the X off of the end of the word works. RX, it's a medical theme. Prayer works for whatever's wrong in your heart. Whatever sin, sickness you might have, prayer works. And this week we've been pulling all kinds of things out of the hearts of little boys and little girls. We've pulled some disobedience out of their heart. Oh yeah. We've got a beautiful ambulance up there that Brother Daniel Cantleberry and his crew put together for us with flashing lights. And I want to thank the Thompsons for all of their support this week. They've got a great crew. Could you give the Thompsons and the Cantleberries and the Cassidys and the whole team a round of applause? I tell you, we couldn't have done it without them. They've been fantastic. And we've just been excited to see what God is doing in the hearts of these boys and girls. So we've got a scripture memory verse that we want to share with you right now.
Dr. Kent, I think there was a really important competition that took place.
Oh, well, see, now that's what good nurses are for, to remind the doctors when they're going wrong. All right, well, along with each one of the sessions, we took an offering. And, of course, we did the typical boys versus girls competition. And we had... In total, let me just give the boys total first. The boys were able to raise for IH Convention, and it's great news. I heard that we don't even need the money. So maybe this will go for next year's convention. But the boys raised $612.37 they did up there in Chapel of the Children. Yes, sir. But the girls raised $877.92. And I got one of the nice parents to pitch in $10 so that we brought it up to $1,500.29 in total. Your children believe in IHC. And I can tell it in their smiles and in their eyes and in their singing. That's how I can tell that they believe in IHC. And you're doing them a great favor by bringing them. And last night, when my little girl came to the altar and just told me what God did in her heart and how she's determined to follow Jesus, I can tell you that God has great things in store for this group of people right here, and he's going to use them. So our scripture memory verse for this year, we're going to say this together. All right, boys and girls, say it loud. That's right. Prepared unto every good work. All right. We learned that we can pray anytime, anywhere, and that God will hear our prayer. Let's sing that. It's Me, O Lord.
It's Me,
O
Lord.
It's Me.
It's Me. It's Me, O Lord.
Favorite parts of the whole service is when we come down to the service where we tell the Bible story and then we have a moment to apply the scripture to our very own lives. And we talk about, are we going to obey God? When we have an opportunity to make a decision between right and wrong? And I just sense in the hearts of the children that their answer is, I want to do what Jesus wants me to do. And I love it when they sing this next song. And I want you to worship with us while we sing. Ready, boys and girls?
Lord,
Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.
You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power.
Holy, holy,
this does my heart good when I hear those voices raised, and holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Well, we have one more song that we want to sing, but now I want to give the parents just a little heads up that when we sing this song, we're going to be exiting off the stage over here, and your children are going to be over there by that white trailer, and we don't want any orphans, you know what I mean? So if you moms and dads want to kind of head that way over toward that white trailer over there, I've instructed the children, unless you've given them other instructions, to kind of hang out by that trailer until you come and pick them up, all right? So you can make your way that way right now. But I think this last song kind of sums up exactly what we've been going through this week up there. And the sentiment of our heart's cry and the heart's cry of these children is to say yes to whatever God asks them to do. I'll say yes, Lord, yes. Let's sing it out, children.
My
Wow. Praise God for that wonderful children's choir. We so appreciate it. Let's stand together. Now, let me just make a correction. We need your money. It's just that we set the budget for this convention for $200,000. And today, that need for this convention was met. And we want to be honest with you. We want to be honest with you. We need your money because IHC is a all 12-month ministry. We have conventions all over the place, international conventions that are coming that we don't even have a plan to pay for. We just know that they're asking us to come preach the message of holiness. I believe you want us to go. And so everything you give is a huge blessing beyond the $200,000, but we need to be honest with you, and we need to praise God for what he has done. This may be first in history. It's the highest amount we've ever had to raise. You've given, God has supplied. God is working, isn't he? Tonight will be our Bible college offering. Let's do our best by our Bible colleges. You are dismissed. Be back tonight. You don't want to miss the patriotic rally, roll call of the states, and then the main service at 6:30 tonight. Kenny Stetler, Mass Choir, Youth Choir, you're dismissed. The Lord bless you. Thank you for being here.